reasonable for the judge to grant another extension. I'm wondering if you feel the same way based on the facts that you just laid out.
I'd rather not speculate on how a judge might rule, but I would say that the way the process works is the city will file a statement of position, the EPA will respond in January, and then the city will have an opportunity to evaluate that response from EPA, and if we're not comfortable with the response, happy with the response, we then have the opportunity to take it to a federal judge for consideration and review in terms of a grant. Now, of course, any change to the consent decree in terms of the schedule would be something that would eventually be filed with the court and need the court's approval. And Conservation Law Foundation is an intervener in that consent decree document. So.
Meaning that they could appeal if they didn't like the ruling, I suppose. But this consent decree has May of 2017 in it.
Correct.
Obviously, we're not going to make that.
Correct.
So we're going to ask for an extension.
There's going to be relief in some form.
All right. Yeah.
Council Dwyer?
I can support of the form of dispute, but I would also ask, in the meantime, are you working on approximate cost estimates for various models of shorter construction opportunities or what the phasing would be like on that?
We have talked about whether there might be some value in putting together a bid which might look at different end dates, if you will, for construction to help assess what the cost would be.
Right. What we talked about with the staff is to do it in such a way as to show certain end dates. One of the things that we would find is that we would probably have to waive our ability to have sanctions against the contractor on the delays because no contractor would bid on it. So we're evaluating that. Again, this is going to be there for 50 to 100 years. We want to make sure it works right, and we're committed to it at 100% designed by December. So. We are working on that.
So essentially, you get it at all.
We'll try to figure out the best format to tease out the best price.
I would suggest, some of us have been through this since the beginning, and we've heard many of these presentations, and it is complex. And every time you go through it, there's at least one detail that I remembered that I forgot. Because of the complexity, because of the importance of the newspaper getting this straight, which clearly they have not yet been able to get straight, I would suggest that you and possibly some members of council ask the meeting with the editorial board to provide this information to them and make sure that before they to help them before they editorialize to fill in the facts, because given the cost to our taxpayers, it's really important that the information be clear to the I think there's been too much misleading of the public during the recent campaign and potentially really frightening people about what the cost would be. We have the facts and we could use a lot of help in continuing to get those facts reinforced.
I'll make contact with the editor tomorrow. I'll see if we can set that up.
Anyone else? If not, Heather Little, thank you very much. Appreciate your presentation. Council Kennedy or Shaheen?
Yeah, I have a question.
Okay.
Both staying inside or that's gone?
We staying inside or that's gone?
Yes.
Yes.
But if you request for money continuously, it'll still be in the subsequent line. Because on 8/3/2015, that was the question, and that was potentially what had stopped at that point.
The biological aerated filter technology has the ability, the design capacity to treat to varying levels. So we have some confidence that we are going to be within the fence line.
And one of the reasons that we have delay is because, it's almost analogous of driving a car and trying to replace the engine while you're driving the car. We have to keep the plant running. And so that's one of the things that costs some additional dollars plus. We have instructed our designers to stay within the fence line. Okay?
rolling average versus the monthly average, are we confident that we're going to have agreement from the EPA on that information?
What we're looking at is a monthly average, but over a shorter period of time. Our challenge is with the wet weather months, April and May, and so we're looking at a different, not an eight seasonal rolling average, but a different way of measuring that. And if I'd rather have the city engineer, Terry Damaris, speak to those limits, because we had the most recent conversation on those limits.
Sure. In our most recent conversations with the EPA, the discussion, and again, this is something that will continue to be discussed, but at this point in time, it was going to be a monthly average, June through October. And then there would be, we'd be monitoring during the months of April and May, and there'd be a seasonal average of eight as well. So that would allow some flexibility for not having to exactly meet that eight in the wet periods, but meet the seasonal average of eight. However, still meeting the monthly average in those warmer months where the bugs are most active.
Okay, so I think it's just worth noting for the folks at home, because of some of the recent press coverage, that one of the reasons there were these questions raised most recently is because we were at 80%, I think it was about 80% design approval based on the eight parts on the rolling average. And the idea of being able to achieve a monthly average becomes difficult, and we don't want to move forward on a plant that gets permitted that we can't hit the levels that are required in the permit. So that makes me feel better. I think we need to make sure that folks at home understand that's one of the challenges that we've hit in the recent months, and that's in part because of this ongoing exchange and negotiation with the EPA about what standard they're going to set.
Correct. Okay, thank you very much. Anyone else?
Mr. Mayor, a quick question on that.
Yes.
Can we go through three parts per million?
So based on the design at this point, and what we've done in that design, there will be no need to extend outside of the fence line to meet that lower limit. And again, it comes down to exactly what that permit limit is, and we don't have that right now for three, so we have not talked about it.
Okay, everyone all set? Terry and Suzanne, thank you very much. Next, we move on to acceptance of minutes for October 5th, 2015, and October 19th, 2015. Second, the roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Next on the agenda is public comment session, and I will say that there are several people who have pre-signed up to speak this evening on different topics. I will ask that when you come to the podium, when I call your name, if you would give us your name, your address. You have about 3 minutes. The city attorney will time your comments, and at the end of 2.5 minutes, he will hold up a sign that says you have 30 seconds left, and at the end of 30 seconds, he will hold a sign up that says thank you. I would appreciate if everyone being responsive and responsible to the other speakers, and only taking 3 minutes, if you need 3 minutes. I'm also going to call on Portsmouth residents first. First to the podium is Michael Berman.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, City Councilor. I'm glad to speak. I'm an Uber driver. I've been driving since December. I'm a Portsmouth resident at 559 Sagamore Avenue. I'm reading this into the record on behalf of Christopher David, who's an activist here in town, who's been before this council before, is unable to make it tonight as his wife is ready to have a baby. Thank you. Dear councilors, last year I moved to Portsmouth from Northern California because I had the impression that this was a tech-friendly, culturally progressive city. Even Google named Portsmouth the digital capital of New Hampshire. So I figured Portsmouth would be an ideal location to build a consulting startup specializing in the emerging peer-to-peer or sharing economy. Imagine my dismay at headlines all this year about clashes between Uber and the city council, with Uber saying they might need to pull out of Portsmouth entirely if the council's new transportation ordinance passed as written. Fast forward to today. There is now a turf war on the streets of Portsmouth that is a direct result of that ordinance. As just one example of many, the Portsmouth Herald reported that the first Uber driver pulled over and cited with a $500 fine under your new ordinance with a grandmother and a part-time bus driver here in this room tonight. The article said that her two female customers were asked to leave the vehicle and they had no other ride. This was at 12:30 a.m. on Friday night. Do you think this law made these girls feel more safe or less safe? Do you think two cop cars pulling over a grandmother is the best use of police resources? The Portsmouth police officers we've heard from don't think so. We've heard you complain about the defiance of Uber and the persistence of activists in posting flyers, but not a single word about the viciousness of some taxi drivers who actively patrol for rogue Uber drivers, ganging up on them, yelling at them, and dangerously obstructing traffic to block in their cars, or even harass people who have just suspected of being associated with Uber. This happens every weekend. Please remember that Uber operated in Portsmouth safely, quietly, and without incident for a full 6 months before you tried to fix what was not broken. Your stated intent in passing that ordinance was to create a level playing field. The intent is admirable, but your methods have been misguided. In my comments at the council meeting back in March, I argued that if the council wanted to create a substantial, sustainable level playing field, they should not add red tape to Uber. They should instead unshackle the taxis so they are free to compete. That remains the quickest and most sustainable solution. So we ask that you redefine the parameters of the Transportation Commission to simply observe and monitor for negative incidents. Otherwise, please just trust that the residents and guests of Portsmouth can use their own judgment about which transportation service to use. If you cannot do that tonight, please, at the very minimum, vote now to suspend enforcement of the ordinance while conversations continue. To do otherwise would continue the egregious waste of time and energy of Portsmouth police in chasing down Uber drivers instead of making our streets safer. Please vote tonight, now, to end the turf war on the streets of Portsmouth. Respectfully, Christopher David. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, Michael. Next speaker, please, to follow, John Calrio. That's completely tell the people of Portsmouth that they need to, if they get in a taxi or an Uber, they get in at their own risk. Taxi companies will be able to lower the prices or the prices. Uber doesn't want to have commercial liability insurance for their independent contractors because they would have to raise their prices to meet ours. Now, fair is fair, level playing field. You, the city of Portsmouth, have told Uber numerous times they need to produce documentation. This is just allowing them to continue to steal money for those who have the five reports.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Next speaker, please, is Ralph DiBernardo.
Ralph DiBernardo, 1374 Islington Street. I'm speaking for my wife and myself tonight, and I am a retired deputy fire chief of the city of Portsmouth. I'm speaking tonight in opposition to any further changes to the transportation service ordinance. Uber does not want to comply with our ordinance. Should we have an ordinance that meets Uber's needs or the city of Portsmouth's needs? Eliminating misdemeanors as an impediment to driving qualification will have a real consequence. All misdemeanors are not inconsequential and should not be cast aside as minor infractions. Here are a few that you should consider. Sexual assault, class A misdemeanor. Assault on a victim over 13 years of age is an assault consisting of inappropriate touching of a sexual nature, such as touching body parts of a male or female. Second, indecent exposure. Third, certain thefts. Fourth, simple assaults. Many felonies are pleaded down to misdemeanors. This changes the punishment, but not the crime. Third-party background checks cannot be compared to the check done by the state of New Hampshire for $25. Uber's third-party checks cannot access history that the state of New Hampshire checks can, specifically history from out-of-state agencies. New Hampshire has access to other state data that third-party checks do not. Uber pointed out that their third-party checks have no access after 7 years. The state of New Hampshire does. Listen to your police department. They have already determined that third-party checks are inadequate. I would like to comment in final analysis here. My concerns are public safety, and I would expect that a public hearing would be held at the second reading if the ordinance is changed. Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. Next speaker, please, is Peter Somsage.
Good evening, City Council. Peter Somsage, 34 Sweat Avenue, Portsmouth. I would like to ask you not to support any changes or suspension of the current transportation ordinance, which is based on requests by Hugo to make other changes. I very much appreciate all the work that the Transportation Commission has put in the past, including the work that Assistant Mayor Blaine has put in to try to accommodate all the requests that Uber have made to operate in our city. I do think that, however, that our local taxi cab companies were really treated shabbily in this whole process. They, in turn, previously had put in significant investments in their taxis and their services, while Uber was able to come along and insist that they would not abide by those rules and was allowed to operate for approximately 6 months in our city without regulation.